I want to welcome you all this morning to the 29th annual meeting of the Alliance. I am Cheryl DeMars. I'm the president and CEO of our organization, and it's my pleasure to welcome you here today. We had about 150 people registered to attend our event, so that's a great turnout. And I want to thank our sponsors, Delta Dental and National Cooperative RX, for their support for our meeting here today. We will have a brief business meeting, as is our custom as a cooperative, but then spend the rest of the morning talking about our strategy to achieve higher value healthcare, better quality at lower affordable costs. And to get us started, I'd like to welcome Larry Pribble, who is the CFO of Trachte Building Systems and our current board chair. Larry, and as you make your way to the podium, let me just let everyone know that this will be Larry's last annual meeting because he's retiring at the end of the year. And Larry joined the board in 2014 and has served on our executive committee for a number of years, and then this year as our board chair. Larry, I would say, is known for asking tough questions and letting us know exactly how he sees things, and we so appreciate that. He also has encouraged us to do some experiments, to take some risks, to try stuff, and we're taking that advice to heart, Larry. So I want to thank Larry for his service, and we're going to miss you. And in the spirit of being opportunistic, which I always am, I want to take this opportunity to say that we're going to be needing a replacement for Larry on the board. So we're looking for a C-suite member of one of our member companies to consider serving on the Alliance board, particularly a CFO or CEO to help us balance the strong HR participation that we have on our board. So if you think someone in your organization may have an interest in that, please let me know. And now, Larry, I'll turn it over to you.
Thank you, Cheryl. Good morning, everybody, and welcome. It's been a real pleasure these last 4.5 years to be on the board. You're all with have chosen a wonderful organization with the Alliance. I'm passionate about the mission. I hope you are, too, and I know there's a blog coming out for our company on what the Alliance has been able to help us accomplish, and I hope you all get a chance to take a look at that and maybe, maybe something will ring for you, but it's been a great partnership, and again, I've been fortunate. The board membership that I've had an opportunity to work with has been just top-notch people that also, like the members of the Alliance, really care about the state of healthcare and what we can do about it. So thank you all for being here. And now with that, they've asked me to keep it brief. So I will start as a first order of business. It's required that we approve the minutes of the 2018 annual meeting. So with that, do I have a motion to approve those minutes? Thank you. Is there a second? Thank you. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Okay. One of the things that I think we should all be proud of is essentially how the Alliance has its mission has attracted new members. In the past year, the Alliance has continued to build the cooperative by essentially finding employers that are drawn to moving healthcare forward. We welcome 21 new members to the Alliance in this past fiscal year. As a result, today we have over 250 members and nearly 100 that represent nearly 100,000 lives. Here are the new members that joined us in the fiscal year that ended this past May. And one of the things I'll ask you to notice is the addresses or where those companies are located. This is no longer a Madison-based cooperative. It has expanded, and we hope it continues to expand geographically. I also want to recognize, since our fiscal year ended in May and here we are now in September, we have other brand new members that have joined us. And here's a list as well. So I want to congratulate all the members that have joined us. And of course, thank you to our continuing members, because it's the membership and essentially that makes the Alliance so strong and helps us give us a stronger voice in moving healthcare forward. The next thing I'm required to do is just talk about our elected board members. Fortunately, all of these have served on the board previously and have been reelected, but essentially, you can see the six people that have been reelected to the board. Our full board, and again, I've had the pleasure of interacting with them, or as Cheryl would put it, they've had the ability to tolerate me, one of the two. But here is our full board. And for the board members that are here, could I ask you to stand, please? Again, thank you so much for your service. This is a volunteer board, but what I know is these people are very passionate about the mission, and again, we see that every day with the leadership and the members of the Alliance, so it's been a great relationship that I hope we continue. So now, I'd like to introduce Paul Meyer to keep this short. Paul? If you'd really hit the business part of this, I'd appreciate it.
Thanks, Paul. Thank you. Morning, everybody. Thank you, Larry, for your introduction and for your ongoing guidance and insights in serving us on the board. You truly will be missed. So I'm pleased to once again be here presenting the Treasurer's Report. Before I get to my prepared slides, I'd like to briefly remind everybody about the ownership structure of the Alliance. I do this every year. It's really important, though, that we understand that we are part of a cooperative and that we're all in this together. You know, the formal business name of the Alliance is, and I actually have to look at this because it just doesn't flow off the tongue, the Employer Healthcare Alliance Cooperative. Okay, so I want to spend just a minute on what the cooperative part of that is. It goes back to our founding. Back in 1990 or so, a small group of employers came together to see what they could do about the rapidly increasing cost of healthcare. Sound familiar? After a year or so of discussion, they decided that banding together and purchasing healthcare services as a group would be the way to go. They wanted to focus on cost and quality, a theme you'll hear more about today. One of the next questions was, how do we finance this thing? And what organizational structure would make sense? $750,000 of seed money was needed to get the organization up and running. The employers that were approached really, I'm told, never thought that they would be repaid. But they contributed, and they contributed in the form of a loan. There were seven founding employers who contributed the seed money. Well, the Alliance grew fairly rapidly, and it didn't take long for those loans to be paid back. The Alliance was organized as a not-for-profit cooperative. As a co-op, when members join the Alliance, they purchase stock in the organization, and they become owners of the cooperative. So why the cooperative structure? Being formed as a co-op helps to assure that we, and I mean we, we're all in this together, and that staff in particular are focused on serving members, not serving investors or shareholders located in far-flung areas. So it's an important distinction. It's really an important distinction, particularly as we work with the provider community, who in many instances are working with those very large health insurers, for example, huge corporations located far, far away. Healthcare providers know that when they're working with the Alliance, they're working with the local employers. It's really important. Those providers are beholden to the communities that they serve, And certainly the employers, you all, are a very important part of that community. So we don't really have the mixed incentives that others have. So I'm here today as the treasurer, giving you all a report as owners of the co-op. So as an owner, you'd want to know, how are we doing as a business? Are revenues covering expenses? Well, this graph pretty much answers that question with a yes. It shows the revenue and expenses by fiscal year over the last 10 years. Tall bar is revenue. The next bar is expenses. That's the kind of ratio that you want, the revenue bar bigger than the expense bar. The difference between the two is net proceeds. And our fiscal year is June 1. So, for example, FY19, which we wrapped up in May, FY19 is June 1, 2018 to May 31st, 2019. You can see that revenue bumped up to almost $8 million in FY19. This is primarily the result of member growth. The slight dip in FY17 was due to the loss of a large member. The bump over the last couple years is due to growth. The increase in expense over the last couple years is the result of filling some key positions, making investments in our analytic capabilities and geographic expansion, two things you'll hear more about later today. Most of the net proceeds as a co-op are returned to members in the form of cash or allocated equity. In the co-op world, this is called patronage. Each year, along with our board, we consider future financial needs, determine how much of the net proceeds to retain as allocated equity, and how much to return in the form of cash. This year, the board of directors made the decision to return 43% of the net proceeds back to members in the form of cash, and to retain 57% of the net proceeds as allocated equity to help us ensure a solid foundation and to increase our reserve levels. We also took the step this past year to pay back stock from former members who'd left the organization in prior years. For those employer members who are in the room, you or a representative from your company has received a check for the cash portion of the patronage for FY19. This is a graph based on our balance sheet. It's a snapshot in time of our books as of the end of the year, which was May 31st. It shows total assets, total liabilities, and the difference, which is equity. There'd be a lot of things we could tease out about this, but I guess the bottom line is that we have a very strong financial position. Assets significantly greater than liabilities. We carry no debt. Assets were growing because we've had solid financial performance and the board has made decisions to increase our reserve levels. It's probably a good time to mention that we are audited. We had a successful audit this year, as we have every year. We got a clean bill of health. The auditors typically comment on the strength of our balance sheet and really the strength of our record keeping. To a large extent, our success depends on us being a significant part of the healthcare market. We've grown from the original 7 employers to 250 employers now, representing almost 100,000 people. We've purchased over $400 million in healthcare last year. With these kind of membership numbers and dollars in play, we're definitely a significant part of the healthcare market, particularly with providers, TPAs, brokers, advisors, PBMs, et cetera. This graph goes to the heart of a very important component of our mission, and that is to move healthcare forward by controlling costs. This graph shows the medical claims costs associated with providing care to the 100,000 people enrolled in an alliance-affiliated plan. It's calculated by taking all the claims we receive for hospital, clinics, ancillary services, applying our contracted rate to get a net amount, and then dividing it by the membership on a monthly basis. So it's expressed as a per member per month calculation. In FY19, that amount was $500 per member per month. We could spend literally an entire day on the cost drivers and things that impact this number. Our goal is to help you manage this cost. You can see variation in the rate of increase in the range of actually a slight decrease back in FY14 to an increase of 8.5% That's the variation over that six-year period. This increase is comprised of both price increase and utilization increase. Think of it as how much you pay per unit of service, and then how many and the mix of service that you might have. So how much per unit is price, how many units is utilization. The price increase is what the Alliance has the most control over through our provider contracts. Over this six-year period, that was typically in the 2 to 3% range of that increase. The utilization increase, or how many services are purchased, varied much more significantly than that, all the way from a decrease over in 1 year of 2% to over 6% in another year. That's an 8-point swing. When we track this against the illness burden in the population or how sick the people are, it actually tracks pretty closely, and that makes sense. The sicker the patient, the more utilization typically. Utilization is an area that's influenced by many things, but a couple of those things to call out here is effective primary care, wellness services, a number of steps that people and employers can take to help people stay healthy and to take care of themselves and then manage their illness when they have it. You're going to hear presentations this morning that describe the kind of work we're doing to help you control this cost. So that's really all I have for prepared slides. I guess in summary, we had another strong financial year. Our balance sheet remains strong, and we're taking the steps we need to help you control your costs. So I started out this morning with a little bit of a history lesson about the founding of our company and the vision of those original employers. They wanted to focus on cost and quality, and they wanted to do that so that they could continue to provide a solid health benefit to their employees. I want to assure you that today we're doing things more so than we ever have done to help you do just that. So I want to thank you for your membership in the Alliance, and I want to also thank you for being here today.
Thank you, Paul, and thank you for your financial stewardship of our organization, both as our board treasurer, but also in your staff role as our chief operating officer. And that, brings to mind the staff of the Alliance, who I'd like now to thank. Would members of the Alliance staff who are here please stand? It is my great pleasure to work with this group of people who have such a dedication not only to our mission, but to the members, all of you, that we serve. And so I want to thank you all for your contributions to our organization. And it's normally at this point that I talk about what's to come in the future, but that's the program for today. That's the whole rest of the morning. So without further ado, I want to introduce our keynote speaker, Suzanne DelBanco, who is joining us as the sun is coming up from sunny California. Suzanne is the executive director of the Catalyst for Payment Reform, an independent nonprofit corporation working to catalyze employers, public sector purchasers, and others to implement strategies that produce higher value healthcare and improve the functioning of the healthcare marketplace. Suzanne is on the advisory board of the Blue Cross Blue Shield Institute, and she's also part of the Healthcare Executives Leadership Network. She was also the founding CEO of the LeapFrog Group, who many of you may be familiar with, and holds a PhD in public policy from the Goldman School of Public Policy and an MPH from UC Berkeley. On a personal note, I've known Suzanne for over two decades now, and it's hard for me to think of anyone else who has spent more time and more energy helping employers realize and exercise the power that they have to change healthcare. It has been her career, and Suzanne is both a friend and someone I admire. So Suzanne, thank you so much for joining us, and we look forward to your remarks.
Thank you so much, Cheryl. I just wanted to make sure that I pressed record. cord so that and make sure that this presentation is available to people who be there today. Thank you so much for inviting me to join all of you, albeit remotely. It's not yet sunny here in California because the sun is due to rise in about 8 minutes, but it will. And it's a pleasure to join all of you. And whether you know it or not, I can actually see you because they've made sure that we've got a two-way camera here so I can see the room, which is really lovely. And I'm glad to join you all remotely today. So what I am going to spend some time with all of you on will be some inspiring remarks about what employers can do to make the healthcare system more responsive to what they need. And so I'll be talking about key strategies for high-value healthcare purchasing. And what I want to do first, though, is for those of you who are not familiar with Catalyst for Payment Reform, just tell you a little bit about the organization so that you understand the perspective that I'm coming from. So like the LeapFrog group, with which some of you might be familiar, Catalyst for Payment Reform is an employer purchaser-led organization that's trying to change fundamentally the way that the healthcare system operates. And Catalyst for Payment Reform's effort is really focused around providing thought leadership to and coordination among employers and other big healthcare purchasers who want to get better value for their healthcare dollar. And since you were just hearing some about how the alliance is structured, I'll tell you about our structure, which is as a 501c3 nonprofit organization. So we are mission-driven. And as you can see, we have a really diverse set of members. We've got large private employers that have household names, companies you've heard of. We also have a growing number of state Medicaid employee and retiree agencies. And we've grown in diversity to include a couple of universities. We've got some multi-employer union trust funds, even a nonprofit employer. And all of these come together through the goal of making the healthcare system more functional and driving higher quality, more affordable healthcare for their own employees and plan members, as well as all Americans. So that's who CPR is. A little bit about how we operate. We believe that we can have an impact on the healthcare system with just the members that we have. Of course, we invite all of you to join in our efforts as part of the alliance because we do believe that a small group of healthcare purchasers can change the system. But the key is to send a consistent signal about what it is that purchasers need from the healthcare system. And if we all ask for the same thing at the same time, our belief is that we will have a louder voice and that we'll do a better job at making a business case for the healthcare system to respond to meeting our needs. In addition, as we push and push, we need to track progress, both to hold ourselves accountable, but also the healthcare system and all the other players in it. The way we go about our work at Catalyst for Payment Reform, I would say we spend about two-thirds of our time trying to make it easy for employers and other healthcare purchasers to become high-value purchasers, to really be effective in the ways that they procure healthcare services, contract for those services, manage their relationships with the vendors and healthcare systems that they interact with. And so we do this through education. We've got all kinds of tools that are available free of charge to any employer who registers on our website, whether they're standard questions that you might ask a vendor or model RFP to secure services. I know a lot of what you get is through the alliance, but even for some, you know, specific solutions you might want to bring to your employee population, we might have tools for that. We also hold the events that are educational in nature. We focus a lot of our effort, however, around coordination, as I was mentioning a moment ago, including things like holding or hosting small working groups of employers to solve common challenges that are keeping them up at night, things like how to work on improving access to mental health services or what to do about all this genetic testing that's showing up on your bills, and how valuable is it to the health care of your plan members, et cetera. And then in addition to all the work we do to support employers and other purchasers in a really practical way, we also conduct research and analysis. We create scorecards and report cards. All of this is meant to shine a light on what's broken about the healthcare system and what we can do to fix it, and also to hold it accountable. So we do regional scorecards on payment reform. We do a somewhat annual report card on state transparency laws, things like that. So that's the mix of what we do, and hopefully that gives you a sense of where I'm coming from as I share the rest of my remarks with you today. So I would like now to spend just a moment talking about the state of affairs in the healthcare system. And I know you all live it, you know, pretty much every day in your roles. We know that healthcare is expensive, and we know that navigating our healthcare system is really frustrating. But I'll just ground that perspective in a little bit of data. Actually, just yesterday, new data came out from the Kaiser Family Foundation about the premiums that employers are paying for healthcare services. And so with an extra moment, I could update this slide, but just really what it shows you is that over time, the premiums have been rising, and the proportion of those premiums being paid by workers has also been rising. This is something I know you know and you live, but when you see it stacked together like this, it's really quite an impressive visual display that shows the pain that many of us have been feeling. The other pain relates to the fact, as you probably also well know, that the cost of healthcare continues to outpace inflation, and it also, you know, eats away at potential wage growth for American workers. We have had a very consistent story like that for quite some time. And, you know, I can just relate on a personal level. I had just last year hired someone fresh out of college. I was very excited to give her a great job. It came with health benefits, of course. And then just a few months later, we got the information about our, you know, for our renewal, what the premiums were going to be. And immediately she was taking a pay cut as soon as, you know, the next plan year started. And I felt terribly about it. But, you know, as a nonprofit, I didn't have a lot of, you know, extra room to be able to adjust that. And so, you know, just seeing it in an individual makes it come very real. So, you know, what is responsible for all this growth? You know, we hear a lot in the news with, you know, the Democratic presidential candidates pointing fingers all over the place, including particularly at insurance companies. But there's a whole variety of drivers of healthcare cost growth right now. Prices are always part of it, you know, how much we pay for each service, how intense the care is we deliver to people. Are we, you know, providing extra tests and extra therapies that are unnecessary? How much people are using healthcare services, just the pure quantity. And then, of course, you know, the growing population, the aging population, the burden of chronic diseases in this country, all of that factors into how much we're spending on healthcare. And, of course, you know, if you've taken basic economics, you know that, you know, price times utilization ultimately means how much you're actually spending. What I think is important to note is that over time, we should expect to see that one of the biggest drivers of healthcare cost growth will be prices. It has been, and it's just growing in importance. And what's interesting about healthcare prices is, of course, they're something that's negotiated. It's not set in stone in the private sector, you know, in the commercial marketplace, how much we pay providers. It really is something that is negotiated. And part of why we are seeing the growth of healthcare prices and its major role in driving healthcare cost growth is because of local market dynamics. So in any given geographic marketplace, you know, the greater Madison area where I live in the San Francisco Bay Area, we see that the sort of power dynamics between healthcare providers, health plans or payers or insurers, whatever you like to call that sector, and employers or other healthcare purchasers really plays out in terms of how much we pay for healthcare. And I'll just give an example that living in the San Francisco Bay Area, we pay about 50% more for healthcare up here than people do in Los Angeles. You know, same state, very different market. In Los Angeles, there's lots of competition among healthcare providers. And in the San Francisco Bay Area, we have a very large nonprofit health system that is essentially a monopoly. And so that really has an impact on what we ultimately pay, and it shows up in the premiums that all of us pay and, other aspects of our costs. So, you know, what's interesting to note, though, is that, again, every market is different. In some markets, it's really the price that's driving healthcare cost growth or, you know, is mostly responsible for the total cost of care. And in other markets, it's utilization. So it does vary. And, you know, in many instances, there have been efforts to root out unnecessary utilization. You know, we identify services that we know are low value. We try to educate people that they don't need to get them. We try to educate providers that they don't need to deliver them. We can change the incentives for all players so that those services that aren't necessary don't keep getting delivered. So there's a whole variety of ways to approach overutilization. Price, again, you know, is something that can be harder because it can just be a reflection of the relative market power of the different players in the healthcare system. And so why, you know, has price been increasingly an issue? There has been a tremendous amount of consolidation among healthcare providers. And, you know, if we were just to go back 10, 15 years ago, most of that consolidation was what we call horizontal. So we had hospitals merging with each other to become bigger health systems. And, you know, there's a whole variety of reasons we hear that this happens. Some people like to argue that, you know, not so long ago, let's say in the decade prior to this one or even back a decade earlier, we had a lot of consolidation among health insurers. So in markets where the health insurers became more consolidated, perhaps the hospitals merged with each other as a reaction to that to try to, again, you know, gain more market power relative to the insurer who they were negotiating with for their prices. There's also been some argument that the passage of the Affordable Care Act, because it really promoted this idea of an accountable care organization, which is this idea of a hospital and physicians working together and being held jointly accountable for all the needs of a given patient population and subject to a payment arrangement that makes them at risk for their quality and financial performance. Some argued that in order for healthcare providers to form accountable care organizations, they needed to consolidate. Now, whether they really needed to, you know, legally become combined entities, that's another question. Many would argue they did not. But there have been a lot of excuses and reasons as to why hospitals have consolidated with each other. And now more recently, hospitals have been buying up physician practices so that a diminishingly, you know, smaller and smaller number of physicians are still operating independent practices where they perhaps feel less beholden to refer patients to particular hospitals or facilities for services. So all of this consolidation has changed the provider landscape in a significant way. And, you know, sometimes in healthcare we have issues we can disagree on and we really feel like the evidence is inconclusive. One thing I think we could agree on if all of us took the time to read all the peer-reviewed published literature on this subject is that consolidation leads to higher prices. I like to say that the evidence for this is about a mile high now. And, for example, in a recent analysis, hospitals in monopoly markets had prices that were 15 to 25% higher than hospitals do in markets where there's four or more hospitals. And, you know, my situation in the San Francisco Bay Area kind of bears that out as compared to Los Angeles. There's also evidence showing that higher physician concentration is associated with higher private insurance prices as well. So, it's really important to understand the dynamics in the healthcare provider landscape in order to understand why price has become a bigger and bigger issue. Now, most of us are used to the idea that healthcare prices bear some relationship to the quality of something we might be buying. So, you want to get a nicer car, you spend more money. You go to, let's say, Target to buy a beach chair, and you want the one with, the cup holder that won't blow over the second there's a gust of wind. You might pay more for that than for the less sturdy one. In healthcare, there just isn't the same correlation between price and quality. And while, as consumers, we sometimes look to price as a cue, or a hint as to what the quality is of what we're buying, in healthcare, it just doesn't bear out. And there was a really nice study that was done recently that looking at the experience of Medicare beneficiaries and those who went to high-priced physicians versus those who went to lower-priced physicians. And they found that while there was some better care coordination happening in the offices of higher-priced physicians, at the end of the day, the outcomes of the patients in those more expensive offices were no better than those who went to less expensive providers. So this is just one of many, many, many examples showing that there really is no correlation in healthcare between price and quality. And there's a whole bunch of reasons for that, but just to go on a little bit further about the state of quality in this country, as Cheryl and I have known each other for two decades, we've really come together mostly around the quality of care, because in the early days of knowing each other and working on the LeapFrog group, the effort was to create some transparency around the quality of care in this country, because just two decades ago, it was very hard to get any information. And in fact, a hospital or physician practice could take out an ad or slap up a billboard claiming to be the best at something because there was no standard way of measuring the performance. And fast forward to today, we have a national consensus group called the National Quality Forum that helps us measure healthcare quality and come up with an agreement on how to do that. And we've just had a tremendous amount more research done on the quality of care, and we have much more public reporting on it, both through the federal and state governments in some cases, as well as even just private health insurers posting information on their provider directories. But what we do know is that for the most part, we have very variable quality of care. We always like to talk about how great healthcare is in the United States, and it's true. We have some of the greatest health care in the world in this country. The problem is you can't count on getting it every time. And as you can see in this chart, which comes from something called the Peterson-Kaiser Health System Tracker, which is a public resource on the web, just 8% of adults 35 and older have received all recommended high-priority preventive services that they should. So that's an example, not even for people who are sick, but for people who are healthy, are they getting the care that they should? A more positive view might be this chart here that looks at how many deaths are occurring that could have been impacted by healthcare. And the number of deaths that are amenable to healthcare in the U.S. have declined over time. So that is a more favorable story. But then let's look at another one that's been in the news quite a lot related to maternal mortality. Here we are in an incredibly developed country with sophisticated medical care, and yet we have seen the number of women who are dying from labor and delivery increasing over the last many years. A lot of this is explained by racial and ethnic disparities, particularly high maternal mortality among African American women. But this is shameful. This is a situation that I find embarrassing and something that we all need to work on. But what's really amazing is that while this is a phenomenon, across the healthcare system, that maternal mortality has been on the rise, we know that which hospital a woman goes to deliver her baby will impact, for example, her likelihood of having a cesarean delivery. So it has nothing really to do with how she presents. Is there a risk of going through with a normal spontaneous vaginal delivery? It's so much more impacted by the procedures and protocols and culture of the healthcare institution, she enters than anything else. So that shows, that there's just a huge amount of variation, and there's some great maps showing the rate of cesarean delivery, from state to state and how much it varies. So one of the challenges we have with, understanding the quality of care is that often the measures that are being used are the ones that are the easiest to collect and show the least variation among healthcare providers because those are the ones that providers agree to report on. But slowly but surely, we're getting more data, and we know that there are massive failures out there that we need to do something about. So now I'm going to turn to the role that all of you can play and why employers are really essential to improving healthcare. And, as Cheryl said, I've, spent the last two decades of my career almost exactly trying to use the theoretical leverage that employers have to pressure the healthcare system to do a better job. But I can't do it just as, a figurehead. I can only do it if I've got employers behind me. And, I just want to stress what an important role you all play because other than Medicare, private and public employers are the biggest consumers of healthcare. 56% of Americans get their healthcare coverage through employers. So all of you together theoretically have such an important role. And I keep using the word theoretical because employers don't always exercise that or know how to. And you guys are lucky because you're part of the alliance, so you have a vehicle, through which you can do that if you take advantage of all, that the alliance offers you. And purchasers do have a track record of making a difference. And I'll go back to the Leapfrog Group, which was started in the year 2000. At that time, except for a couple of states which had posted some information on heart surgeries, there was no public reporting on quality at all. You go to Consumer Reports to look at dishwashers or cars. There was nothing like that to compare hospitals or physicians. And Leapfrog, created some standards they wanted hospitals to report their adherence to and created a voluntary national survey and propped up a website in 2001 that started showing the differences across hospitals. And so that idea of standard quality measures and public reporting was really sparked by employers. Leapfrog was founded by GE and GM and at the time what was called GTE, now Verizon. There were a handful of employers that saw that they needed to change the way the healthcare system was functioning, and so they pushed for those standard measures of performance and public reporting on that performance. And now we've got federal and state governments displaying that information, and again, like I said, commercial health plans and others. Then the idea of paying differently based on performance was also spurred by employers. Bridges to Excellence, another employer-led effort, created the first physician pay-for-performance program that basically pushed physicians to adhere to certain quality standards, and if they did, they could earn a bonus. And then the broader payment reform movement, the desire to change the way we're paying doctors and hospitals so that we can get better quality, more efficient, more affordable care, was started by Catalyst for Payment Reform in 2010, again, led by employers. And what's important to know is prior to 2010, for about 3 years, CPR's early incarnation spent time educating policymakers who were writing the Affordable Care Act. And so all of that's in there is a blueprint for Medicare and in some cases Medicaid on how they should go about changing a healthcare payment for providers was in part sparked by employers educating policymakers about what the federal government should do. And now Catalyst for Payment Reform is essentially providing the thought leadership and direction for the commercial sector as part of that payment reform movement. Furthermore, as our members were in pursuit of higher value and wanting to do some interesting benefit designs that required their plan members to understand what different services would cost from different providers, we needed to push for price transparency because in addition to wanting to know the quality of different providers, it's important for consumers to know what different healthcare providers are charging and what out-of-pocket costs each consumer will have. So all of these movements were started by employers. If it wasn't for employers, we wouldn't have information on the quality of care to compare providers. We wouldn't have payment reform. and we would not have any insight into what the prices were that providers were charging, unless you're an organization like the Alliance, and therefore you do have some insight. But for the most part, employers don't typically know that. So I hope that's inspiring to you as a call to action as to why what each of you do on your own and through the Alliance makes a difference. So what can employers do? So we think about four core drivers of high-value healthcare going forward. We've already talked about transparency and the need to have insight into quality and prices. Benefit design, the incentives that consumers feel, also play an important role because we want to make sure that not only do consumers have information, but they also have motivation to act on that information, and I'll talk about that a little bit more. Also, provider network design is really critical, whether it's relevant in Madison or more so in other markets. Sometimes when we know there are big differences among healthcare providers, it's important to think about which provider should be in-network and which should be out-of-network as a way of signaling to consumers or plan members where we would like them to seek care. And payment reform, as I mentioned, we think is critical because we need to change the incentives that we're providing to physicians, hospitals, and other caregivers. So now I'm going to delve into each of these a little bit more deeply. I've already talked some about transparency, so I won't spend too much time here. But again, I just wanted to say that, you know, with leapfrogs spurring, there's been an increasing amount of quality information available from public and private sources. So just some examples, at the federal level, if you are a Medicare beneficiary, you have all kinds of resources you can look at now, like hospital care as part of the Medicare website. At the state government level, it varies state by state, and I'll talk about that a little bit more, but there are some states that have websites that are up that will allow consumers to see quality comparisons and cost comparisons. There are also some nonprofit sources like the LeapFrog Group that continues where you can get grades for hospitals based on their safety scores. And then if you are a plan member of a health plan that has invested in creating a provider directory that's annotated with both quality and price information, which is true for most of the large health insurers in the country and an increasing number of regional ones, you can get access to information. Now, are these all perfect? No. Almost in any given instance, if you find a patient who has a certain healthcare need, they're going to be challenged to look on a website and find just the information they need to help them make an informed decision about their particular course of care. But at least we have some information that at least shows directionally, you know, how well a health system or provider practice is performing. Which is a step up from where we were, you know, a couple of decades ago. Now, there's been a lot in the news lately about what's happening in this space, in particular because there's been a presidential executive order. It's called the Executive Order on Improving Price and Quality in American Healthcare to Put Patients First. There's also another bill in Congress called the Lower Healthcare Cost Act that is pending, and both of these really emphasize the need for transparency. Some of it's about transparency for patients to be able to see information, like we've been discussing. Some of it is really about transparency into the relationships that exist between payers and providers. So, for example, there may be situations where it gets negotiated into contract that a health plan is not allowed to display price or quality information for a particular provider who obviously in this case would have a lot of market power to be able to negotiate that in. But this happens, and not only do they prohibit health plans sometimes from displaying this information, but they also may even prohibit the health plan from acting on that information in benefit design or network design. These so-called clauses are anti-tiering or anti-steering, and I'll get into that in a little bit more in a moment, but they essentially get in the way of acting on the information. There's also activity that's been happening at the state level. You know, as I mentioned, we put out a report card almost annually on state transparency laws. And we're at the place now, we're out of 50 states, we've got 16 that have what are called all payer claims databases, where Medicare, Medicaid, and private insurer, and sometimes self-insured employer data are combined to create a more robust view of what's happening in the healthcare system in terms of cost and quality to the degree that it can be measured from claims data. These all payer claims databases are organized in different ways state by state. Some of them have then gone on to create consumer-facing websites that do display information about price and quality and total cost of care at different providers. And so I think we're going to see more of this. It's very challenging to get all payer claims databases up and running, but we have some great models in Colorado and New Hampshire and some other places that have not only created these databases but then made data available very easily for employers and consumers and others to use. Now, filling in these gaps, again, we have private health insurers. We have independent vendors like Castlight that employers sometimes contract with directly to put out this kind of information in a user-friendly way for employees and family members. So we've gotten some good headway on transparency, and one of the reasons why at the LeapFrog Group we wanted there to be such transparency is because if you want to start tying how we pay providers to how well they perform to try to create an environment that's more conducive to improvement, you need to have that information in order to start creating those incentives. So let's take a step now to talk about payment reform. So in our view at CPR, and I just say this because, you know, payment reform can mean something different to each of us, it really means a range of healthcare payment models that use payments to promote or leverage greater value for every stakeholder involved in the transaction. So, you know, typically we think about provider payment reform as being something that impacts the healthcare provider. But at the end of the day, if the way we change how we pay doctors and hospitals is not sustainable or beneficial to all parties, then we're not going to have a sustainable model going forward. So that's why we bring all these other stakeholders into our definition of payment reform. So the way we have traditionally paid for healthcare in this country is in what I would call sort of an a la carte manner. It's what we call fee-for-service. So some of you may already know this, so bear with me if this sounds too basic, but the idea historically has been that we have paid a separate price for every unit of service, whether it's an office visit, a diagnostic test, a laboratory test, a procedure, a service, a hospital stay. They all had their own fee schedule, and each piece is paid for separately. Now, there are advantages to this, which is if there are services that you want providers to deliver, paying fee for service gives them an incentive to do so because the way they generate revenue is to deliver more care and more expensive care, and then they get paid. The downside of our legacy payment system is that it was completely agnostic to quality. We paid those amounts regardless of the quality of care, and there were no incentives inherent in the payment except for an incentive perhaps for more utilization. So as the payment reform movement got started, it really focused on pay-for-performance, this idea that we can come up with some quality measures to use to track the performance of healthcare providers. And if they do well in those measures, then we can give them a bonus. And while that kind of upside incentive can be effective for getting providers to pay attention to certain processes of care, and in some cases improving outcomes, it really doesn't do anything to address the cost of care. So as we think about other ways to pay for health care that could create the right incentives, we move from the left of this table sort of toward the right. So how could we go from a la carte to more of a package price, where either we're paying a package price for everything that goes into a certain episode of care. For example, for a hip replacement or a knee replacement or even caring for someone with diabetes for a year, all the way to what we call full capitation or global payment, where it's a set amount of money per person over a course of time for a group of providers who are responsible for that patient. And we sort of go, you know, again, from the micro payment to the macro. As we move from left to right, we are more likely to encounter the resistance on the part of providers because they don't necessarily want to be at financial risk for caring for people if they feel like they can't control that risk. On the other hand, it gives them more autonomy and flexibility for how they go about spending that money. And it creates greater accountability, which is good, of course, for those of us who are using care or paying for care. So this is really the spectrum of different payment methods that we see. All of them can be improved because we want to make sure that all of them, if they're in the marketplace, which they all are, have a quality component so that they're creating incentives to improve quality. And we want to make sure that they are leading to the right incentives around efficiency as well. So all of these methods are likely to continue to exist. I think it's just the proportion of how much we use each of these in the marketplace that's going to vary over time. Today, we still have, you know, primarily a fee-for-service chassis under all of our payments. Most of the payment reforms that we've seen taking place are adding financial bonuses or potential financial risk for providers on top of those fee-for-service payments because it's very hard for health insurers to change their legacy approaches to paying for care. When CPR got started in 2010, we did an unofficial query of major health plans to find out how many of them were tying their payment to performance in some way, and at that time it was just between 1 to 3%. Fast forward to today, we still don't have data for 2019 because we're in it, but for 2018, we know that we're somewhere over 50% of payments now to doctors and hospitals having some kind of incentive for quality attached to them. And so that's a big deal. We really have made sweeping changes to how we pay for healthcare in this country. What hasn't changed, as I said, is sort of the underlying fee-for-service approach, which still, you know, has those incentives for more and more delivery of services. But what we've been trying to do is sort of put Band-Aids on top of that by creating incentives to be aware of the total cost of care and control spending and also to hit quality targets. So one of the things at CPR that we like to say is that it's not payment reform unless it touches quality. It probably also shouldn't be called payment reform unless it addresses price to some degree, given the evidence I shared with you earlier. And we should also even think about the relative amounts we pay for things in a fee-for-service manner, because in some cases we pay too much for things that are happening too often. So if we maybe lowered the payments, we could reduce things that were unnecessary. Let's say testing for vitamin D levels, which people have agreed isn't that beneficial. If we started paying, you know, pennies on the dollar for that, we probably see a lot less of it. And we should start paying for things that we haven't paid for that we know are beneficial. For example, time for physicians to help coordinate a patient's care. In the past, there was no payment for that, so everything was fragmented and no one had any reason to spend time on it. But if we started paying for it, we might see that practice increase. So there's a lot to do here in improving our efforts at payment reform. We need to continue to evaluate the approaches that are being tried to see what works and what doesn't. And we also need to think about how to align the incentives that the consumer has through benefit design with the incentives that the provider has through payment reform. And I'll just share briefly that, you know, there really have been mixed results from our early efforts at payment reform. There's enough there to be tantalizingly optimistic. We've seen, you know, in accountable care models that I described earlier that, you know, there have been examples of some higher quality of care and some lower spending or lower utilization. but we've also seen examples of where accountable care organizations really made very little difference. There have been enough promising examples that bundled payment or sort of episode-based payments that I was describing a moment ago can improve the quality of care and can reduce duplication of services and tests because they require providers to work together. But in some cases, they haven't had much impact. So long story short, we still don't know the magic bullet, but we continue to work and iterate to figure out what approach to payment reform can work. As I mentioned, you know, maybe it's not payment reform if we also don't address prices. We're seeing some really interesting efforts by very large purchasers to try to address price. For example, using how much Medicare pays, which is typically less than what the commercial market pays, as a benchmark, and setting the prices for hospital services, as an example, as a percent of Medicare. So the state of Montana, the employee health system there, has taken this approach because they are very large. They're a critical customer of every hospital in the state, and they were able to negotiate this. I think this will be much harder in other markets. It's being tried in North Carolina. There's been a lot of pushback, but this is an interesting approach that we're starting to see. So, you know, we're catalysts for payment reform. You would think I could stop my presentation here because I've already talked about payment reform. But when you think about how to, as employers, to pursue higher value in the healthcare system, you can't just stop at how you pay providers. You also need to think about what providers you're making accessible to your plan members and also what incentives you're giving them. So that's what I'm going to cover here in the remaining part of my presentation. So we have seen, especially among larger employers, that working with provider network design is really starting to take off. Employers are eager to find ways to really connect their plan members with providers that we know that deliver a higher value. And doing a high-value provider network can help with that scenario. So we're seeing that purchasers are experimenting with both what are called tiered networks and narrow networks. Tiered networks are you know, sort of the PPO network, the very broad access network, where a consumer would have to pay more if they go to a provider in a lower tier. A provider would be in a lower tier if they were too expensive or poor quality or both. A narrow network where essentially the poor value providers are removed and consumers have less choice, but they perhaps can have confidence in knowing that the providers they go to are of higher value. And we're seeing these practices really tick up in interest among larger healthcare, larger healthcare purchasers. The study that came out from the Kaiser Family Foundation yesterday showed that among smaller employers, these practices are barely being looked at for a whole variety of reasons. But I think sometimes looking at the jumbo purchasers out there is a way of seeing what's to come to the rest of the marketplace. And we are seeing these practices really take off. In addition, we're seeing more employers directing their plan members to centers of excellence for certain services and procedures where we know quality really varies and where they're spending a lot and where prices can sometimes be very high. And we're also seeing employers really investing in both on-site clinics as well as near-site clinics that they share with other employers as a way of both increasing access to primary care but also helping control utilization of what could be an overpriced healthcare system by really being thoughtful about referrals from that clinic to community providers. So we're seeing a lot of activity in this area. And there is some evidence that these network designs can really work. So as an example, there was a study that was published in a peer-reviewed journal, the American Journal of Managed Care, that showed in the southeastern U.S., consumers who enrolled in a narrow network had lower mean outpatient out-of-pocket expenditures and 10% lower premiums than individuals in the broad network plan. And again, you know, the idea is that if you get rid of the providers that are very expensive and who don't have high value to offer in terms of the combination of cost and quality, you can save some money. In Massachusetts, the Group Insurance Commission, which is the agency that buys for state employees and retirees, created a narrow network, and there they found that enrollees in those networks spent 36% less than their peers who were not in that network. And they also experimented with a tiered network and found that the poor performing providers lost market share. They lost patient visits as a result of being designated in a lower tier. And so that meant that the enrollees in that plan were seeking care from higher value providers. Blue Cross Blue Shield of Massachusetts separately in the same state put together a tiered network and found that it reduced total adjusted medical spending per member per quarter by 5%. And so that, again, sometimes is enough to negate the trend that we're seeing in healthcare costs rising each year. What I think is interesting to think about is, historically it's been very un-American to restrict choice in healthcare. And in fact, as employers, most employers hate doing it because they don't want to disrupt their plan members' relationship with their physicians. They're afraid of, dealing with angry employees who want access to a provider who's not in network or who's in a lower tier. But what we're finding, I think, is that we're really at a turning point. Americans in the past were so concerned with the breadth of benefits and less concerned with the cost. Now it's really reversed. Healthcare, as you know, has become so unaffordable for so many Americans that they are willing to make a trade-off now between choice and affordability. And one example is one that we did a case study of. One of our members is Qualcomm Incorporated. They're based in San Diego, and they created a narrow network around an accountable care organization contract they created with Scripps Health. And they had estimated how many people they thought would enroll in it, and the numbers far surpassed their estimates. People went to it in droves, and the retention from the first year to the second year has been something like 91 or 92%. So people are not only happy with having a choice, but are also selecting that choice and sticking with that choice in situations where they get a more affordable option. But I think it's critical as we go forward that we make sure that these narrow networks and tiered networks really consider the quality of care as part of their criteria. Because if it's just cost, I think we will find pushback from employees and others who become skeptical at the motivation of putting these kinds of networks together. So now let me just spend a few minutes on benefit design. So we talked about which providers plan members would have access to. Now let's talk about their out-of-pocket costs and other incentives they have in terms of the cost sharing. So we're really seeing, like with the provider network designs and the innovation there, a lot of interesting high-value benefit designs taking off. And these really fundamentally focus on connecting consumers with the services they need and with the best providers. So we're seeing, just from the last year's survey by Will Charles Watson of employers, that 33% of large employers are increasing out-of-pocket costs for services that are overused. So they're trying to make it less attractive to their plan members to seek services that typically people might use in ways that aren't medically necessary. We're also seeing more employers requiring that employees use a second opinion service before getting to proceed with a particular procedure or service. One example that I really love is one that we also did a case study of. This is Walmart, and of course, Walmart's in the news a lot for innovation in healthcare. And it can be hard to imagine as a smaller employer that you could mimic, what they're doing. But they did create a center of excellence program for spine surgery because they were finding that a lot of people get spine surgery and it doesn't help them. They know from they were aware of this from the medical literature that when people are having low back pain, there's a lot of steps to try before surgery and that surgery is often not successful. So they wanted to create a situation where they were making sure that if associates of Walmart were getting surgery, that it was going to be beneficial to them. So they contracted with some centers of excellence. They paid them in a bundled manner, so that was a set package price for the care. But they had a separate payment for evaluation of the patient. So a patient at home might be referred for spine surgery. They would go to the center of excellence where they would get a separate evaluation, and that center of excellence would get paid for that evaluation. So if they turned the patient away, they weren't going to lose everything. And they found that 50% of associates who had been referred for spine surgery were told that it wouldn't benefit them, that they'd be better off doing physical therapy or trying some other course of treatment. And so in this situation, it's kind of horrific to think of how many people would have had surgery that comes with risks, comes with pain, that would not have left them any better off. And they also found that only 2% of people who were turned away from the surgery went ahead and had it anyway at home. So the benefit design they put into place for this was to waive all the cost sharing so that it was very attractive for associates to choose seeking care from the center of excellence rather than from a non-center of excellence surgery center. So I think that's a great example of where benefit design can really help people get the right quality of care. Another example is CalPERS, which is the state employee and retiree purchasing agency in California. They found that they, for joint replacements, were paying wildly different amounts. I can't remember the exact amounts, but it was like, you know, between $15,000 and $160,000, you know, for joint replacements across the state. And so they did some research and figured out that if they set a reference price of $30,000 for joint replacements, they would still have plenty of access for, you know, the millions of people for which they buy benefits. And they could, you know, save some money by telling their plan members that if they seek care from a provider that's at or below the reference price, they will maximize their benefit. If the plan member chooses to go to a more expensive provider, then they will have to pay the difference out of pocket. And by instituting this program, they had high-priced providers coming to them saying, could we please lower our price to the reference price in our contract so that we don't lose the opportunity to treat your members? And so all that ultimately led between patients choosing providers who met or beat the reference price and other providers negotiating lower prices, the average price that CalPERS was paying for joint replacements went down 26%. And the selection of high-value providers increased. And so that, you know, another example of a very effective benefit design. So I've talked to you about a lot of things. You know, what are your potential strategies for the future? You know, as employers, you first and foremost want to create a great healthcare benefit and experience for your employees and their family members. You know, that's your first and foremost concern. But if you only look inward and don't look at, you know, outward at your potential role in influencing what the healthcare system even offers to you, you will be at a disadvantage. And again, you know, you guys have the opportunity of working through the alliance to really influence the healthcare system. But if the alliance creates new programs that allow you to do these cutting-edge practices using benefit design and network design and payment reform and transparency to really, you know, deliver higher value care, both for your own employees and their family members, as well as in the way that you influence the healthcare system by selecting those types of programs, you know, you will have an impact on the local market dynamics and the amount of competition you spur among providers. And the education that you bring to your plan members in terms of all choices not being equal and why it's important for them to look towards those higher value choices. So I've talked about price and quality transparency as a fundamental driver and building block for a lot of these efforts, benefit designs that can really encourage employees to choose high-value services or high-value providers, custom networks that can really encourage and make it easy for plan members to connect with high-value providers, paying providers differently so that they have incentives to be good stewards in terms of the quality of care, the efficiency with which they deliver it, ultimately how affordable it is, and also addressing healthcare market dynamics and prices through a variety of approaches that can really stimulate competition among healthcare providers and address that issue head on, because all the reforms we put into place, you know, if we don't try to address prices, are going to be, you know, really challenging. So with that, I'll stop. I think we have a few minutes for questions, and hopefully with the way the room is set up, I can hear you and we can engage in some dialogue. So thanks for your attention all this time.
So much, Suzanne. So we have microphones sprinkled throughout the room. Please feel free to make your way to one to ask Suzanne a question. And Suzanne, while that's occurring, people are getting their thoughts together about that. Let me start by asking you one. We were having a discussion before the meeting started about employee engagement and the importance and the challenge also in helping employees be aware of their role as a consumer and the things that we need them to do to be effective in that role. And particularly, you know, people don't need healthcare interventions all that often if they're healthy, but then when they do, they may not remember something that we told them 6 months ago. What guidance do you have about how to make this, I don't know if top of mind is the right word, but to get employees information in real time when they need it and to engage them in their role as a consumer?
Yeah, it's a great question and a very common challenge. We actually created a collaborative, a small working group of employers to address just this, and created a toolkit that's freely available for people that has all kinds of messaging in it. But the bottom line is you can't just think about open enrollment as your one moment to communicate with people about your healthcare offerings and the things they need to know. It has to be throughout the year. So it's not just about what healthcare choice they make, in terms of an insurance option, but then throughout the year, how should they be utilizing the healthcare system? And, you know, investing in those communications and repeated communications, you know, takes a lot of effort, money, and time, but that's really the way to do it. The only other thing I'm going to say, and it's not that we should give up on that endeavor, but what I think we've learned, if anything, from over the last 10 years is that there's some, you know, employees and family members who really like the idea and relish the idea of being active healthcare shoppers. There are others who are just not that interested in it, and I think that's why we're seeing real investment now in these provider network designs and benefit designs to really try to point people to the choices that we think are going to serve them best. So it's not just reliant on them looking at information and acting on that information.
Good, thank you. Questions? Let me ask one more then. Not to hog the floor, but I will. I'll ask this one last question unless there are others. So, Suzanne, a lot of your strategies talk about things that we as employers can do in a free market approach. And I'm just wondering if you have any thoughts about the role, this is a broad question, but you know, you can narrow, the role of regulation or legislation in addressing some of the things that we're trying to fix in healthcare. Where do you think that belongs, if at all?
Yeah, absolutely. You know, we also study state laws related to cost and quality in healthcare. We actually partnered with the law school, the UC Hastings College of Law here in San Francisco, to prop up a database that we just actually put up last May. So I can direct Cheryl to share that resource with everybody. So you could look at the state of Wisconsin and see all the laws that are on the books that affect the ability to do all these practices that I just shared with you today. So there's no question in my mind that healthcare dynamics have gotten so challenging in certain markets, especially with this provider market power and the prices, that there's a role for policy intervention from time to time. And, you know, some people who are sort of against government intervention or laws, you know, impacting the free market can appreciate that I think sometimes regulations can actually make the marketplace work better. And so we're seeing all kinds of approaches that states are doing, some of them very innovative. We are really pleased to have that resource available so people can take a look, and we're periodically writing articles about the themes that we're seeing, and I think whether it's trying to impact prices or making sure that people have the right to shop for healthcare services, you know, rooting out antitrust behavior and non-competitive practices, all of those things have a role. You know, we obviously spend all of our time trying to make the marketplace work, but we are quick to admit that there are times when, you know, policy intervention is just going to be necessary.
Great. Thank you, Suzanne. And thank you so much for joining us virtually through the magic of television. We look forward to future work with you. Thank you so much.
My pleasure. I hope you all have a great rest of the day.